got to call Carl. What about his?
I have a call, thank you again for allowing us to talk for today. Thank you for watching over there tonight. Thank you for just allowing us to be here and to be able to humble down and to bless everything that's about to happen. Bless his commission that they make some decisions that are gonna affect the lives of all people getting to the Cordele. Bless the commissioners that they make some decisions that may not always be what we expect, but still bless them. Because they're with you and the Lord. In the name of our Heavenly Father, we ask thank you for what they do and what you do. Thank God that we are still here. In the name of our Lord. Amen.
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 Word quick.
Today's bird trip. I'm a proud member of My Brother's Keeper Cordele, and I am the project team leader for My Brother's Keeper Leadership and Elected Official Team, which focuses on accountability, integrity, transparency among elected officials, government leaders in the city and the county. As you may or may not be aware, tonight, Tuesday, August 4th, is National Night Out across the great nation. National Night Out is an annual community building campaign that promotes police community partnership and neighborhood camaraderie. To make our neighborhood safer, a better place to live, National Night Out enhances the relationship between neighbors and law enforcement, while bringing back a true sense of community and provides a great opportunity to bring police and neighbors together under positive circumstances. Before this meeting, My Brother's Keeper, My Sister's Keeper held our first annual Church Everywhere National Night Out event in the heart of the city on the southeast corner of Joe Wright Drive and 16th Avenue, an historic corner in our community, full of very rich and history and heritage. You may recall that My Brother's Keeper conducted his first annual Cordele community survey back in January, only to find that the number one concern by far from citizens taking the survey was the issue of crime in our community. No surprise, since according to the University of Georgia Cooperative Extension Service 2014 Georgia County Guide, Chris County Index, a full 69% higher than the state average for total crimes committed. Tonight, My Brother Keeper was joined by members of the community and the clergy on National Night Out to make a statement that we are taking a stance against crime in our neighborhoods and communities. We invited law enforcement to join us, including the Cordele Police Department, the Chris County Sheriff's Department, but neither showed, making a powerful statement by how little they truly care by their very visible absence. With that, we're curious to know what the process and criteria will be for the selection of the next police chief. And we urge this body to conduct a search that is fair, transparent, and puts the needs of the citizens first. We are sure that you can agree that more of the same with growing crime statistics is unacceptable. Finally, on this National Night Out, My Brother's Keeper is concerned about all crimes committed in our community. And in light of some of the recent revelations about the city of Cordele's finances and about certain government leaders charged with handling taxpayers' dollars, we're requesting a forensic audit of the city's finances and a criminal investigation to uncover any crimes and illegal activities. To that end, My Brother Keeper has prepared letters with supporting documentation for the State Attorney General, the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, the United States Department of Justice, and the Chris County Sheriff's Office requesting a criminal investigation into the city finances, and of those charged with oversight of these finances. As always, we stand ready and willing to work with this body and the community to ensure the truth and justice always see the light of the day in our great city. In layman's terms, we're asking for accountability. We're asking for transparency. People in this room and around this community, elected the majority at this table, be accountable to them. It's essential that they hired you. You didn't hire them. And transparency is something that we need in this community. And we're just asking you to do what you swore to do. Okay? Take care of the people of this city on all levels. Thank you for your time.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Looks like y'all got a long agenda tonight. I'll try to cover the audit. I'm gonna hit highlights, but at any time, if you got any questions, don't wait to the end. Feel free to interrupt me and ask any question under the sun. Again, I am here today to present to you the June 30, 2014 annual financial compliance audit. Again, June 30, 2015 has not been fully closed out yet by city officials, and has not, the audit's not been conducted. So this is an arrears in a certain respect. The state requires you to have your audit conducted and delivered by 12/31 if you're a June 30 year end. You all did get an extension requested of the State Department of Audits and Accounts. They granted it, and I'm happy to say you got it. The 6 month extension was through June 30th. I think you got it out June 30th that evening. So it went out the door. No violation of law, no problems there. But again, it is delinquent from its normal presentation. Typically, this is done during the fall, issued by Christmas, and out the door. So again, I want to introduce myself a little further just to tell you who I am. Again, my name is Miller Edwards, and I'm with the firm of Mauldin and Jenkins. I've been with the firm 29 years. Cannot believe I can say such a thing. To give you a little background about our firm, the government experience we've got, we're by far the largest firm in the state when it comes to serving governments. We currently serve about 300 governments. Of those 300, about 250 of them, 225 are in this state. We serve about 80 cities, about 40 counties, 40 boards of education. It's all I do. Don't ask me a 1040 question because I will not be able to answer it. Again, I never thought I could say such a thing as that. When I got into being public accounting, I thought I'd be Mr. Tax Guy. But years later, I'm doing nothing with government. So again, wanted to share that with you. One of the first things I'd want to know if I were in your shoes is, after all said and done, and the delinquency of the report coming out, what was the nature of the audit opinion? And that's of great importance. What you want to hear from me is what you're going to hear from me. And that is, you got what we call an unmodified opinion, meaning, in layman's terms, a clean audit opinion. Now, what that means is,
you need to restate that. A clean
audit opinion. A clean audit opinion on your financial statements. Meaning, we do believe the financial statements that have been prepared and submitted to you do present fairly, in all material respects, the financial condition and the results of operations of the city of Cordele as of for the fiscal year ended June 30, 2014. We do have findings. We do have recommendations for improvement. But when it comes to your financial statements that are presented to you, we do believe they're presented fairly. Okay? That's what you want to hear. Okay? That being said, what I'd like you to do is help me walk through and give you some highlights of some things. And, does everyone have their audit report with them? Do they have the audit report or just the agenda?
I gave it to them last time.
Well, let me touch on the audit report. Okay, Ms. Farsi, you got yours there.
I have one.
Okay,
I've got
the mic. Maybe, there we go.
That's why I was surprised when you handed me another one.
Well, we have an audit agenda. We can kind of summarize it. Then we have the financial report. But the financial report is what I will look at first. And if you can turn to page 4 tells a story. That's your balance sheet. Now, your balance sheet is only good for one day. Okay? That's the case if you had a June 30th, if you had a June 29th, if you had a 9/15. Whatever your balance sheet is, it's good for that day. Just like your own checkbook is only good. The balance that is good for that day. Okay? So the balance sheet is what we call the statement of net position here. And what it shows is that you have a certain level of assets and a certain level of liabilities coming out to net position, which we might also call equity or net worth. When you look at the total column, which is what I would spend my time looking at, so you got governmental activities, business type being like water, sewer, gas, and that kind of thing. But if you look at the total of the city, you've got about $42 million worth of assets. Very important to understand that in that $42 million, there are some liquid assets called cash and investments. You've got $14,542,000 worth of cash and investments at June 30, 2014. So, I'm not sitting here and say you're fat and happy, but you're also not, going bankrupt anytime quick. Okay, so you've got good, strong financial position. Financial position is when you talk about your cash investments, your liquidity to meet the obligations that are currently due, okay? You go down below there, you come down to a subtotal that says $9,739,000. That's your current liabilities. Oh, actually, that's all your liabilities. That's your long-term debt, your short-term debt, everything. And you can see, when we've got $14.5 million in cash and investments, that's there, and you've got liabilities that total up to $9.7 million. And of that $9.7 million, about $6 million of that is long-term. I mean, it's not due tomorrow. It's due over a period of time, 15, 20 years. So really, you look at it, you've got $14.5 million in cash, and you've probably got about $4 to $5 million in current liabilities, things like accounts payable that are due within the month. Pretty good financial position at the end of the year. Again, nothing to brag about, but nothing to write home and say, oh gosh, we've got problems. You've got equity position of $32 million. This is looking at your balance sheet for the city as a whole, combining all funds, putting on a full accrual basis, and looking at this like you were a business. Okay? Any questions at this point? Again, this is a snapshot for this day, June 30, 2014. If you turn to the next page, it goes landscape. You have to turn the book a little sideways. Typically, when you're used to looking at an income statement, the first thing you see in income statements is revenues followed by expenses to come to a bottom line. Well, Gadsby 34 and all of his wisdom back about 13 years ago said, no, we don't want to do it that way. So the standards require us to show expenses first and work across with direct offsetting revenues and work down with any kind of general revenues like property taxes. If you look at the first column, you can see what it adds up to. $16.8 million. Everybody see that? That was the total expenses of the year for the city of Cordele's operations. It took $16.8 million to run this overall city operation. Key thing to remember, what was what I said on the balance sheet? You got $14.5 million for the cash. Okay? So that means to me that you almost got a year's worth of reserves overall sitting in cash and investments to fund the upcoming year. This would be the same kind of thing as if I told you that you earned $50,000 a year, and before the year gets started, you've got $44,000 in your pocket. That wouldn't be too bad, would it?
That'd be great.
If you have $44,000 at the beginning of the year, January 1st, and you're going to earn $50,000, probably in pretty good financial shape at that moment in time. That's what this is telling me, 14.5 compared to the 16.8.
So what's the rule of thumb? I've heard a different number. What's the rule of thumb of assets you need to keep on hand in case of something happens?
Okay.
2 months, 3 months, or what?
Number one, I'm going to have to say it depends. That's not the right answer. That's not the answer you want to hear. But what I am trying to say is you have to measure that throughout the whole year. Let me ask you this. When should the, in the world of property taxes and everything, what's the fattest time of year this city ought to be? I'd say around 12/31, maybe November 30th. That's when y'all should be. Property taxes are coming. That's right. Well, the problem with 6/30, June 30 is your measurement date. That's when you start to get kind of skinny. I tell you, there's two counties in this state, for example, Cobb County and Gwinnett County. Both of them are AAA rated. Cobb County's a 9/30 year end, and Gwinnett's a 12/31. Their balance sheets, because of those dates, look totally different. Cobb County is skinny, almost anorexic at 9/30. They're waiting on property taxes.
Well, the reason I mentioned it was that you got to put a nice asset sitting up there. Some people say they are raising taxes, but they got money already set aside.
You've got to have this to carry you for these months that are out
that's
in front
right,
of you.
Right.
You've got to be able to get from June 30th, you have to get through July, August, September, October before those property taxes start coming in. And then, of course, the question is, in any community is, what's the right balance to maintain even with that in mind? And that depends on if you're proactive, trying to improve the situation, or if you're going to be reactive and not able to fund initiatives. If you want to fund initiatives, it takes funding on the front end to be able to do that. So again, I would say that depends on the situation existing at any city or county, or any board of education for that matter, is what's your initiatives right now? Are we trying to grow this thing? Are we trying to widen roads? Are we trying to do all these different things? That takes initiative, that takes funds, and you'd like to be able to do it proactively, not reactively. So I'll leave that up to y'all to decide that. But there is no magic number of do we need 2 months, 3 months. It depends on when you're measuring. If we're measuring this thing at 12/31, I'd say you need like 8 months.
Well, you understand the question.
I do.
Hurricane, tornado,
right.
Wipe the town out, and that's what I mean.
You need to have what you need to withstand all contingencies. That's right. So again, I think overall, looking at it, you had about 16.8. If you work across, you had these direct offsetting revenues. Then you work down. See that total column that's the next to the last column? You you see those bracketed numbers? That was the net cost of each of those functions. For instance, and this should be no surprise, public safety, the net cost of $4,380,000. Now we go down, you see we've got 5.9. We're digging ourselves in a hole with expenses. How do we get out of the hole? Property taxes, sales taxes, alcohol beverage taxes. And we got out of the hole, we ended up making $2.2 million. Okay. Some of that's cash, some of that's non-cash. Depreciation, for example, is a non-cash expenditure. Another thing you might need the cash is if you're investing in your fixed assets. If you go out there and buy a fleet of police cars, you buy a new fire truck, that's not expense through here. That's capitalized. So you have to look at this like a cash flow statement. And sometimes you actually have to make a good positive bottom line to fund debt and to fund capital outlay type things. Trucks, tractors, all the things that cost. So I look at this and say, not a bad statement. One very key thing to pick up in this particular statement at this time, you all had a really nice little, some rain came down during the year. It was called TEAC, T-E-A-C. I remember approving that. Well, you ended up selling your gas commitments, what you had out there. You had an opportunity to bring in gas at a certain level. You sold it because you decided you didn't need it. And guess what you made on that? About $1,870,000. That was a great win right there. Okay. Now that being said, that's including this $2.2 million. So without it, you might have only made about $350,000. Just one, you know, in the world of transparency, just share that kind of information. Not a bad year, but there was a once-in-a-lifetime sale that you all resulted in a really good positive gain from. Hats off to you for picking up on that opportunity and taking advantage of it.
What hats? Hats what?
Hats off to you.
Okay.
Again, a good looking statement of activities looking at that. If you could, let's go to page 6 and 7. 6 and 7, we now get down to probably the fund level. This is what you're used to seeing. You're used to talking about the general fund and talking about, you know, the capital projects funds and those kind of things. The one thing that jumps out on me as I look at it is I know that you all, while you have a lot of cash, you all didn't formally transfer monies from the gas fund and from the water and sewer like you've done the last few years, which caused the general fund to show a loss, okay? You even had a certain amount of it budgeted and you didn't transfer, so it caused the general fund to have a loss. Now, what does that mean when I say transfer? Let's pretend we're all one big family, and she's, Mama, she's got all the money, and we're all sharing one checking account. And you draw some from it, I draw some, you're good, you've actually paid Mama back. But at the end of the day, Mama's got this one account that's got several million dollars in it. I'm the general fund, and I've kind of overdrawn this year. But my water fund did real well, my gas fund did super well. They have lots of cash. You all have something called pooled cash. And it's one cash account that you share the activity in that one account across funds. This particular time, the general fund actually owes more than it took in. But the gas fund and the water fund are just the flip. And you all didn't make that formal transfer that you usually do to transfer those monies. So it caused the general fund's situation to look worse than it really is a good way of putting it. So again, I think you look at the overall city, you're in good shape. You look at the funds, I'd recommend that you go ahead and make some transfers, go ahead and formally get that money moved, so that you don't have to sit there and say to yourself, well, the general fund's in a hole. Yeah, it is, but if you turn to like page, and you go back here, I'll just slide some numbers. If you go to page 12, you've got $2.8 million sitting in natural gas and water sewer.
Well, is it because we're not charging, it's another term they use, not transfer, you know, when we charge a department to the general fund for doing business.
Well, I'm not sure I'm following.
Well, you know, you say transfer, but I've heard another auditing term that we supposed to charge all of the departments for doing business.
That would be true. You need to do that as well. But typically, your proprietary funds in government typically make money and transfer to the general fund to help offset the need for taxes. Your brethren right down the road in Albany, Georgia, they got something called the Water, Gas, and Light.
It makes a lot of money, it moves it over to the general fund to help supplement.
A lot of places
do, and you all do too, but you didn't formally transfer it this year.
Well, I was not, right, they have a board there.
They did.
Yeah, they did, they don't have a board anymore.
Water, gas, and lights now been merged in with the city.
Okay, but you know what I mean, conditionally they have, you was elected to the water, gas.
That's right. But a lot of governments, like LaGrange, Fitzgerald, like you said. They don't have a separate board, but it's just an activity that helps make the money for the city, and they move it to the general fund. Y'all need to consider doing the same thing. Again, if you look at the city as a whole, $14.5 million to start a year at a lean point of the year, it's not bad to be able to fund those future months. And, you know, it's a pretty good situation. Again, not to brag on it, but you're not on bankruptcy's door either. Okay. And also,
well,
as
yeah, is,
yes,
based on that rumor going around that we are throwing it, they're using all kinds of funds, I'm not going to do that. But we're supposed to have a tremendous bond rating. Tell this crowd what that
means. Okay, a bond rating, yeah. You heard me say like Cobb County and Gwinnett County AAA.
Right.
I'll give you some other communities off. Forsyth County has just become AAA. That's North Atlanta. Alpharetta and Roswell and Sewanee. They're all clients we audit as well, and they're AAA.
Right.
But think about where they are and the money the economics of the community.
Right.
When a bond rating is given to someone, it's more than just looking at you, the government. It's looking at your entire community. And, you know, let's face it, where I'm from Macon, Georgia, we're not Alpharetta either, you know. Every community of bond rating is looking at your overall ability as a community.
Bottom line, though, if your bond rate is not good, you can't borrow any money.
That's true. You want it to be as healthy as possible.
Right? That's what I'm talking about.
You absolutely do. But your government can only have so much input in that.
Right.
You know, I've seen fat governments that still only had a AA rating. You're like, why? Because the economics of the overall community aren't what it needs to be to get that AAA rating. And again, think of the ones I named. Alpharetta. I mean, Roswell. Those are communities in this state that are considered to be some of the most well-to-do, and that's where their rating oftentimes comes from. You know, Valdosta has good-looking financial statements, but they're not AAA for the same kind of reason. So again, but it is important, there's no doubt, and I'm sure that bond rating people do look at the direct health of the city in making a certain level of their decision.
It's something to help out if you're trying to build a building and trying to get a
price. Absolutely.
That's what you do that for anyway.
Absolutely.
Yeah, right.
But again, I just wanted to touch on those highlights. I think, again, overall, y'all did pretty good. I do recommend, as I've recommended this to y'all in the past, and I'll recommend it again, I do recommend y'all consider amending your budgets. Use the budget as a tool. You know, if you realize that maybe sales taxes are running a little bit behind, make an amendment, let's bring it down, and maybe we need to bring some expenditure down. Maybe we need to postpone an expenditure in light of that. You need to make those kind of decisions more often during the year. Look at the amendment of the budget, at least on a semi-annual basis. That's what a lot of clients do. They're June 30, they do it at 12/31 January. They say, we need to amend the budget. I would recommend y'all consider doing that. And I also recommend you consider transferring those excess funds at the water, sewer, and the gas and gas, and consider moving that over to prop up the general fund for the moment. And then go forward with really using the budget as a tool and really working that budget as often as possible. Not letting it just sit there as a one-time budget, never to be addressed and amended again. I did not formally put that in here, but I'm here today to tell you I do that. I have formally put it in different management letters in the past, and I'm just saying it again. I don't have to say it every year, but I thought I'd just skip it written, and I just tell it to you orally.
Right. You say an audit statement will require the correct supplement and balance.
We had a lot of adjustments.
Adjustment, it means that's what it says. If you transfer money to another department and you're not doing the thing right, you have an adjustment to complete that.
Adjustments are typically associated with bookkeeping issues.
But the word on the street that we were going to hell on the basket, but you know, it's been implied that, you know, you heard the gentleman up here talking about legal overhaul and all that, you know. People think not because the Constitution says freedom of speech, you can say anything without liability. You know what I mean?
Well, I understand. Some of this comes, sometimes, and I will say, it's all about communication. It's all about communication. And, I think it's communication's a two-way street. I think you've heard their voice. I think now we're voicing some facts. Hopefully that helps everybody have a better understanding of things. If there's still more questions, let's have more communication.
There are more questions.
I thought that was open, right?
Mr. Miller, I want to make sure everybody in the room kind of understands, make sure I'm understanding correctly.
Okay.
You said, out of a $16 million budget, we already have $14 million.
Oh.
In cash. The other high point would be that I think as Mr. AJ's referring to is the $1.4 million that we were overdrafted. It was not overdrafted, it was just the funds weren't balanced.
It's essentially different with other funds.
Correct. So everything was fine.
There's no NSF charges from the bank.
Right. And so in your opinion, in your separate opinion from the city, you would say maybe that those numbers were misrepresented, misunderstood by the people kind of looking at that?
To everyone's defense, and I'm going to impeach my profession. Okay. When GASB was created in the early 80s, one of its covenants when it's created is to make financial statements more consistent with other governments, make them more reliable, and also make them more understandable.
Correct.
I think GASB has lost that concept in the last 30 years. These statements are so hard for people to understand, even people at my firm that are CPAs that don't do any governmental, they look at this stuff and say it's hieroglyphics. They don't even understand it. That's how complicated these financials got. So if somebody is misunderstanding it, I very much understand why.
But, I'll just make my personal...
So again, I think I can keep my impression when I say that.
Well, I just make my personal opinion on this and just think that, as a group that would come to the community would be to better benefit our community, would be better to kind of come to and say, hey, are there some explanations on this? And there would be some better understanding. My personal opinion, my father's always said that your last name is what carries on past you, and I think long after I'm gone and the people in this room are gone, Cordele's still going to be here, the name of our community.
True.
And as a community and as a group that who has tried to say they're bringing our community together, they've kind of tore our name down. And I say that to the sense of I've come to the body and try to understand. It's just like if we could speak of take the liberty here, say if we're looking at, let's use scripture for example. If we look at a word, that word is surrounded by sentences, which is surrounded by a paragraph, which is surrounded by the context that it was delivered. When we take things out of context, we can make it look to whatever it is. And I'm not saying that. I speak for myself, I want their opinions, but I think as a community, we need to come together and build ourselves up, not tear ourselves down. So we need to be careful, both as a commission and as a community, about what we do.
I don't disagree with you, but again, it is hard to understand. I've heard the term in my world, this is smoke and mirrors. I heard that term down here back in about 1997 at an authority down the road, that this was smoke and mirrors. And unfortunately, sometimes the way GASB makes this financial information presented, I actually understand why a commissioner might say this feels like smoke and mirrors. We're taking it over here, we're not taking it over there, we're moving it over here. It's complicated.
Correct.
And so what I'm trying to say to you all today, and that's why I turned to that first page and said, if you look at the whole city, not individual funds, but the whole city, $14.5 million in cash and investments, on a $16.8 million budget. Not too bad. You told me that I was making $50,000 this year. Here's $44,000 to start with. That wouldn't be too bad.
Are you all taking questions from the community?
Yes, sir.
Concerning?
This is not a public hearing. We'll let your question.
All right.
It's not a public hearing.
All right. My question is to the accounting firm. When you do the audit for the city, what accounts do you, what are your procedures as far as all of the city assets? You take all of their bankers' account, right? All the funding, grant money, splash money, everything, right?
Try to.
You include all of that into your audit, correct?
Try to. Let me explain when I say that. I knew that was kind of a crazy answer. But what I mean by that is, in the world of an auditor, the risk on an audit is the overvaluation of an asset, not the undervaluation. The risk is the undervaluation of a liability, not the overvaluation of a liability. And so when we're looking at an audit and someone presents us their list of assets, we don't go on the chase to say, are there other assets out there? Because that's not a risk typically in
right. That's
society.
Not. I'm not so, talking about the assets.
Well,
if
the cash the city, is the asset.
If the city have accounts,
yes,
just a checking account, all of the accounts are included into your.
That is
all
the
right.
Goal. That is the objective.
All right. I did an open record request requesting the audit for 2014. I went. We have bankers as yourself went through the audit, and you have accounts that are not included in the audit that you have no access.
I'm unaware.
I know you are. We have proof. I have the proof.
The question that one person shared with me today, those funds were transferred into the general fund's cash account right before you were in.
Exactly.
But it's in there. I'm saying it's in there.
You are exactly right. But why was that not added into your audit?
It is. That's what I'm saying.
It is. But prior to that, they was constantly using that account. But you just told us if you unaware of that account, it would have been included into your audit report. Of the city account have a bank number, right? It have a separate account number.
Yes, sir.
From the city. All of their checking account.
Have a separate checking account number with the institution that the funds are deposited
it's
with.
It's the same bank.
Yeah, well,
it's the same
some
bank.
Clients, I'm saying, have them in multiple banks.
Are you talking about Public Works account?
You know exactly what I'm talking about.
Mr. Fulford, would you elaborate on how we use that fund that has been out there?
Probably 95% of it's been spent on employees, feeding employees and prisoners. And
when somebody dies, you send flowers.
None. None.
Stuff like that. But the money is turned in at the end of the year.
I understand that, sir. But why was that checking account not a part of the audit?
It was.
No, it wasn't. You didn't give me the copy when I did my work.
It's not getting out of hand, Mr. Rivers.
So maybe he is an auditor too, but you know.
I never claimed to be an auditor. I never claimed to be an auditor. Like he answered the question. He said that the city have accounts, and all of the accounts, this one banking account, the public work account was not added into the audit.
The funds are in it.
The actual bank statement account was not added into the audit. No, sir, that's not true.
If the money's in there, it's because the money's been recognized through a transfer from that account to the general fund.
I understand
and
exactly what you're
recognize that as cash coming out, cash going into another fund.
You're absolutely right.
Can I get clarity on one thing you said, though? Can I get clarity on one thing you said?
Yes, sir.
I'm going to let them.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The fund that you are interested in, and you and I both know what fund that is, I have all of the accounting records for that fund. It's been in existence for 20 or 30 years. The lady that was so kind to spread all of this malicious talk has been fired from the city. And she is a very, very, very vindictive, discontent employee. And you and others, I'm sure, are just carrying her hatred and spreading it all over.
No, sir.
This guy right here.
No, sir.
Steve Fulford, he is the one that is responsible solely for that $1.8 million that Miller talked about just a moment ago.
Yes, sir.
And these things that you think has taken place have not taken place, Mr. Ray. I promise you. And this is not the proper venue to do this in. We brought Mr. Edwards here to
Mr. Edwards is answering the question. We understand the numbers. He's explaining the number. If my wife have a checking account and I have a separate checking account, those are two different accounts. Like the city have several accounts, right, sir?
Yes,
sir.
Right.
But you include all of those accounts.
I'd include
into
your wife and yours into your joint financial statement.
That's exactly
statement.
What
right.
I'm
that's
saying.
That's what they've done here.
And they have, you have account. I did an open record request for 2014 and went through every account that the city have. That account is not in the audit.
It's captured as part of the transfer with the general fund.
Can you clear up one thing you said?
Accounts are in existence today, Mr. Ray.
Okay.
And again, I would appreciate the opportunity to try to talk to you about this, but
I come.
Can,
Well, while we're on this issue, there's a big word out there that there's a bunch of insufficient charges that would run in, but how many insufficient check charges do we have? Thank you. But yeah, they're everywhere.
And that's malicious gossip again. Everybody is being told that we are overdrawn by $1.4 million. Well, that would get my attention if I was reading that. That's a blank, bald-faced lie.
Yeah.
This man right here is telling you that we've never been overdrawn by $1.4 million.
And I know this man is not going to put Martin and Jenkins' reputation out there once he sees the supporting document.
Can I get clarity on one thing you said to the people, please? You said, and which I understand, okay, the city has numerous programs that money is appropriated to, okay, funding, right? And you got the general fund, okay? You say the general fund was overdrawn, okay? And I understand you're saying these other programs made money, the money just wasn't transferred over to the general fund. My question is, why was the general fund overdrawn? Okay, I don't want to talk about all the other programs, okay, because in the beginning of the fiscal years, okay, money is allocated, okay, to those different programs, okay, and they got money to spend, okay, because we budget, okay. Let me finish, okay, and we palm for the years and we say, hey, I'm going to need this amount of money to support me this year, okay.
Yes.
Those programs got their money. The general fund had its money, and it spent all the money, and it spent over, okay. We're yes. saying, what was it spent over on? That's the big question. I don't want to talk about all those other funds.
Okay.
If you were listening to him, he explained it.
I'm going to listen to him if you give me a chance to listen. Okay. Well, I tell you what, you ain't in charge of me. I can tell you that. I can lead the meeting. I don't have a problem leaving the meeting. You ain't in charge of me. Don't you ever think you're in charge of me. Okay?
I think I can.
Now, you can give me an answer.
I think I can give you an answer, and I hope it works for you.
Thank you.
The city, as part of its budget revenues, that did not.
What you pointing at me for? I ain't said a word to you.
I think everybody knows.
I'm here as a citizen, and you're pointing at me and threatening me in front of all these people.
I didn't threaten you anyway.
Okay. Looked awful.
Can you answer the question? Please don't distract from the question. Please get an answer to the question.
You are correct that the city spent more than it took in this year on the general fund.
On the general fund.
Okay, but part of that.
On what is the question?
It's all broken out these different categories.
That's the point we're making.
Sir, let me finish, and then you can ask me another question. Okay.
Go ahead.
They overspent this year primarily because revenues didn't come in as originally budgeted. Okay. They also didn't make that transfer. You heard me say earlier about how normally they make a transfer. Typically they make a transfer. It was even budgeted to be transferred, but they didn't actually transfer it. Okay. I don't know why. It would have been easy to just move the money over there, which is what they historically have done, like a lot of governments do. They didn't do that. Consequently, that fund at this moment in time looks like it was out of control. It looks like it spent way more than it took in, and the biggest reason was revenues didn't come in as budgeted, and they didn't do the transfer. Now, what it was spent on, that's broken down into the various departments in this. To get a greater detail, the city would have to give you that. We only break it down to a certain level by department.
Right.
Okay, the standards don't ask us to go down to the nitty-gritty.
Right. And that's what we're saying. We have it. I don't want to belabor this and keep going on. People got things to do tonight. Appreciate the time. Mm-hmm. Appreciate you coming.
Well, I hope.
I'm clear.
Okay.
And we'll move forward with where we're going. Okay. Right. Thank you all.
Can I ask one more question?
Yes, sir.
Who was supposed to transfer that money, Mr. Miller?
Well, I'm not going to say who because. I think it's one of those kind of things you have to look administratively and say who.
Would it not have been the obligation of the finance director?
You would think that that person would have brought it to y'all's attention. You would have thought and say, hey, we have this budget item. Should we move it over or not? Apparently, that question had come before you all. Okay. I'm not going to get into who should have been, what, when. It's really, that's great. That's really great. The biggest issues we've got when it comes to this overall audit, getting back to why it was in the rears, why it was so late, is the 8 material weaknesses that we had. If you turn to page 55 in the audit, I'll just cover those real quickly. I'm not gonna get into super details, but I do want y'all to have some understanding of what we have here. On page 55, the first finding that we had, and these are what we call findings or material weaknesses in this case.
May I make a statement for you, please?
Yes, sir.
That's the reason we're on debt trust. That's the reason you have an audit, to find out what you're doing wrong. Your weaknesses,
and then the auditor tells you what they do to work, or regulate.
We're trying to do it.
Right, and if somebody been stealing or doing anything, he's supposed to tell us that too. But just to, you know, you could like to say, worries of all, most people and businesses have audits to find out internally what they're doing wrong. Not for themselves. We've been got somebody that's been doing it all
years.
Yeah, right. And on these pages, you know that what was properly drawn. You got it on about 8 pages, and then you put down that what should be done or what. So correct.
Yes,
that's right. And then all we need to do is correct what we've been doing wrong.
Well, what we had this past year, I'll just say it in layman's terms, is we had a bookkeeping nightmare.
That's what I said on these pages.
In layman's terms, I mean, that's what it's all about. Is you get in the world we live in. I live in a world of debits and credits.
We took care of these.
Well, I hope. Yes, but again, what we've
so
got.
We're on our job.
How did you take care?
We took care of that issue.
How did you take care of
it? We took care of that job.
Okay. On page 55, we've got a first finding was a general accounting. We have specific findings that are behind this, but the first one was just general accounting. And overall, we had a real problem this year conducting the audit. We typically come out here in early October to do the June 30 audits. We were asked not to come out by the former finance director. Can you postpone it for a couple of weeks? We said, sure. Rearranged our schedules. She then asked us in late October, can you postpone it again? I said, okay.
That's the finance director.
That's right. She then said, can we come in December? I said, that's fine. That's going to get awfully close to the 12/31 deadline. She then said, as we got closer to December, can we just wait till the early part of the next calendar year? I said, well, you're going to file an extension with the state. I said, and then we'll have to get it done by June 30th. We came out here in mid-March. We were out here, typically we're out here for 2-3 weeks. We were out here for about 3 days. We finally said, you know what? You're not ready. It's time for us to go back home and not waste your time and ours. We then came back out, had a conversation with her during April and May, and then we came back out in June and said, it has to happen. You don't get another extension. Unfortunately for city management, the city administrator actually had to roll up his sleeves and get in the middle of it as well. And we got this baby cranking out the door. But it was a nightmare on our staff, on the city staff, of trying to get this done. And it just gets back to general accounting. General accounting of just taking care of debts and credits. When you turn to the next couple of pages, you'll see taking care of accounts payable. Accounts payable, the city is supposed to have all these invoices coming in and know all these expenses that are going to be paid in July and August and have those things booked and reconciled to the general ledger. Not done.
Right.
You turn to the next page. Due to, due froms. Due froms are where we're all one family, and I owe 100, he owes 50, you owe 75, we owe you. You know, we go around. At the end of the day, it's all supposed to come out to zero, what we all owe to the table. But that's got to get reconciled. And it wasn't reconciled. It was not coming to zero. There was time had to be spent getting that taken care of. On the next page, we talk about cash. Cash was not being reconciled in a timely manner. Cash is the most sensitive of all assets. I think we all agree, cash is the most sensitive asset. That should be reconciled monthly. It was not being done monthly. And we had adjustments related to it. Another thing we had on page 61, recorded revenues, receivables, and deferred revenue. If somebody owes you money, that's a receivable. You put it on the receivables listing, it's supposed to reconcile to what's on the general ledger. That was not done. Capital assets. When you buy trucks, you're supposed to expense them in the general fund. That's part of the smoke and mirrors thing. You expense them, but you've got to keep up with a detailed listing of what you own as far as assets and reconcile it. That was not done. Accrued liabilities on page 64. At the end of the year, outside of accounts payable, you've got things like accrued payroll. Don't the employees want to get paid?
Yes.
Shouldn't the city recognize their amount due at June 30th, even though the pay date might be the next week? That was not done. These are basic fundamentals of accounting that were not done, that we had to make happen in June of 2015 relative to the June 30th, 14. And then the last thing was management of inventory accounts. If you've got inventory, gas, fuel, any kind of inventory that you're going to put on the books, there has to be a detail of it. That was not done. So we had those type of things that were problems in getting the audit done because so many accounting functions were not getting completed. Okay? That's what it comes down to. At the end of the day, after everything finally got adjusted, I'll stand behind these statements. The statements reflect things to be correct. But it took a significant action. These statements are correct. It took a significant action on everyone's part to make this happen because things were not being done from an accounting standpoint on a regular, timely basis.
Whose omission is it?
Well, again, every community has a finance director, and that's typically one of the chief responsibilities of a finance director.
And it's making
sure such things reconcile.
To validate.
They had computer problems. But you know what?
You got that in there.
But you know what? You still got to figure it out. You got to get it taken care of. Every business, you got to get the debtors' credit. And if it doesn't balance, you got to find out why. You can't just sit there and think the magic is going to happen. It's going to go away.
And where was this finance director in the last week or so of this?
I have no idea. Okay. All right. Those are our findings. Eight findings that are really pretty significant. Okay. We've also got other recommendations. They're not anything that we need to talk about today. We've discussed them with management. I think they've got a good handle on things. These are things that I need to make sure you understood. These eight findings. They speak loudly to me. And the beauty of it all is, I'll say this to everybody in this room, every one of these findings should be gone next year.
Exactly.
They're not rocket science. I don't live in a rocket science world. Okay. I don't have to worry about E equals MC squared. I don't have to do that. I'm just trying to balance books, debts, and credits. With the right person, with the right focus, with the right understanding, every one of these accounting matters can go away. There's no issues that are going to be lingering forever here at the city. Okay. So again, I think this is, and I've had that situation before where all findings the next year go away. So it may be difficult this year for June 3015 because you're so late now taking corrective action, and we will be auditing all of June 3015's fiscal year. So you might see some repeats, but that doesn't mean they won't get corrected by the fall with the proper people in place to take care of them. Okay?
Well, you made that statement about audit 13. I went and found 13 audit, and it's been going on back there too.
Yeah. What's been going on?
We
had problems from time to time in any government. I think back in 13 we had something revenues and receivables not being properly reconciled in a timely manner. But it was only that one finding. It wasn't everything.
I know it, but so that's the job at all.
Rather than things getting better, it got worse. But again, take away from this, the findings can go away, and you actually have a pretty good financial position across the city. If you look at the city as one entity, which it is, it's one entity. It's got one employer identification number. It's one entity. You've got $14.5 million at June 30 in cash and investments on a $16.8 million budget. That's not too bad.
That's not too bad.
Okay.
Sir, can I have a question?
We don't have any more questions for the board.
Any questions?
Can we schedule an open forum there where the people can talk? You got numerous people would like to talk to you.
We'll adjourn this meeting for 10 minutes, and you can ask Mr. Edwards any questions you want to.
It's great leadership. Great leadership.
Or if you're not in favor of it at all, and of course unfortunately runs through our 311 system. All replies are completely anonymous.
Haven't had any replies.
I don't have four.
We'll address it in the next meeting.
And I'll bring the poll if you want me to go to the website and whatnot, let y'all know, or I'll share that with you in my report next week.
Like any other old business, any new business?
Speed stop, speed testing around the recreation facilities, mainly 22nd Avenue. Down by the basketball court, getting a lot of complaints about speed and all that, and we set up speed testing around that area and all of the recreation facilities in the city streets. Right? We can get to that. And the last thing in the new business, the railway museum.
Proposed railway museum at the corner.
I want to propose the naming of that to Jimmy Carr, AJ Rivers, Railway System. That'd be fly right there. Got to get you fly while you're there. We propose the name of that bill, Dr. Mr. Williams, and our very own House President, Mr. Jim Corbin.
And that building is through the Downtown Development Authority. If y'all so wish, I'd be glad to convey that over to the authority as we start the process.
Right, ma'am. Go ahead.
I'm going to wait till you
get. Any other new business? Commission priorities.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This evening we'll go over some events that were held in the last couple of weeks since we met. The IDC meeting with an award presentation was on July the 22nd, Wednesday. This was held at the Chris Power Board Room. Piedmont Construction received an award for their design and work on the dark downtown campus building here in Cordele. They also gave a plaque to the IDC recognizing the achievement, thanking the group for their participation. Very nice for them to receive that. And they were very appreciative to have the opportunity to work in Cordele, Chris County with all of us. The Georgia Manufacturing Alliance Tour, Sarah Brown conducted this tour with a representative of the Alliance. They toured all the industrial economic sites and intermodal center. We held a retirement reception for Chief Cooper on July 23rd. Commissioner Butler was cordially invited to this, celebrating his years in law enforcement and celebrating his retirement. There's an IDA executive director interviews. I've had those on July the 24th, the 30th, the 31st, and August 3rd, assisting in conducting interviews for potential candidates on these dates. Chamber of Commerce executive board meeting on July 27th. Commissioner Rivers and I were at that meeting to discuss various issues involving city participation. The regular board meeting is the next morning at 8:30 at the Chris Regional Boardroom. And again, Commissioner Rivers and I represent the city at this. We held a pre-bid conference regarding the intermodal rail spur project July 29th, Wednesday. We met with engineering staff, potential contractors to discuss the project and scope. This was held in the Public Works Boardroom. City staff and I were also present. There were three potential contractors on this. Call for bids has been advertised on July 24th. Bid opening will be on August 25th. The State Federal Agencies Workshop, July 29th, City of Cordele hosted the first in a series of workshops sponsored by our Georgia Municipal Association regarding state federal agency funding opportunities. Cordele's meeting was held in the courtroom here on the second floor. We had around 50 people in attendance. The qualifying advertisement for the 2015 city election was advertised on July 31, 2015. The advertisement ran into dispatch this day, and qualifying packets are available for pickup at the clerk's and also the assistant clerk's offices. Copy of the advertisement was included in the packet as Exhibit 1. Meet with historic preservation representatives Main Street on August 5th. That has been postponed to August 19th on that at 10 a.m. We will have, though, River Valley is going to send in their historic preservation people. We're going to meet the Main Street office and working on the inventory and the rating of the historic structures in downtown Cordele area. The regular Main Street board meeting will be on August 12th, Wednesday at 8 a.m. at the Main Street office. National Night Out event, August 15th. This will be held at the Community Clubhouse and Grounds. and its purpose is to provide connection with the community and our police department, and also providing school supplies for children. Future dates of interest coming up, August 19th, 21st, is the QS1 Governmental Software Conference. I am planning on attending that conference. August 25th will be the Renaissance Strategic Visioning Program Town Hall Meeting. I'll have the advertisement out posted on that. That will be for public participation for the University of Georgia reps to visit with us here in our hometown. Again, August 31st to September 4th is qualifying week for the upcoming election. September the 24th is the State of the Court Address in Savannah. And also on the 24th will be the Public Safety Dinner, where we recognize our public safety officials and employees. In my action report this evening, the National Night Out event. Here again, it is a national recognized event. Partner police and public safety agencies with the community to promote relations with one another and make children in the community aware that public safety is a function to help people in the community. I have included a flyer regarding this in Exhibit 2 in your packet. And if Sarah's still here this evening, yes, would you mind saying a few words about this? I know you and Jeremy have worked really hard to get it together.
Yes, we have. Jeremy and I have worked together for this event. We have had an outpouring of sponsorship and a lot of community involvement in this one. 20 of our community sponsors have gotten together. This is a community-funded event, so all of it comes from our community. So we're very proud that we were able to put this together. We have loads of games and loads of prizes, and we just want a big crowd for the day and build that camaraderie and trust between our law enforcement and our community. And we have included our sheriff's department, so we will see Mr. Billy Hancock with us that day as well.
Thank you, Jared, for that. We're looking forward to it. The Renaissance Strategic and Visioning Program professionals, as I said earlier, were recently in the community holding focus and strategy group meetings, surveying the public as to needs, desires, issues with historic downtown Cordele. Members of the community that could not attend one of these sessions, I would like to make sure that you know we have an online survey to receive public comments on the plan of work. Please go to our Cordele Main Street website. That is cordelemainstreet.com. Take time to complete the survey. It is only 5 to 10 minutes. You'll note it is on the main page, and it's listed as Welcome to the Cordele Historic Downtown Planning Survey. And we would certainly hope you give your honest opinions on this. This is what we have those professionals in here for, is to see what the community needs are, what needs to be done out there with our historic structures. And I put the cover pages in Exhibit 3 in your packet on that also. Mr. Reeves, Commissioner Reeves, as I said earlier, the city website, Cordele 311 poll for the honorary naming of a thoroughfare. As requested for the workshop meeting earlier last week, the City of Cordele website is posting the question and responses that can be done on the website or through Cordele 311 as to an honorary naming of a thoroughfare in the City of Cordele in honor of Dr. Martin Luther King. The proposed streets discussed in the meetings were as follows: 24th Avenue from 7th Street westward to the city limits, 7th Street from the north to south city limits, and also 6th Avenue from 7th Street westward to the city limits. It's also noted that signage and recognition of the street could be most easily done on the 6th Avenue location, as the city already owns that property at the corner. And we would ask citizens of Cordele to respond to this by please going to our website, cityofcordele.com, go to the Cordele 311 website, cordele311.com, or you can call 311 from any phone that you have, or use a free smartphone app. I would like to let you know that we have named an interim police chief. And I'd like to announce that has been named for the city as Colonel Lewis Green. He is stepping into this role for his second in command post. Colonel Green has been with the city of Cordele a significant numbers of years and is highly regarded in public safety circles. And we are certainly honored as a city to have such a great candidate within the organization to assume these duties as we search for a permanent police chief is underway. And Colonel Grant, I just want to say thank you for accepting this leadership role.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, sir. The next two items I'm going to pass until later time, until I have more information for the commission. I do want to request your approval of a road closure due to railway work on the CSX Highway 41 7th Street. Department of Transportation officials has asked to detour the traffic away from Highway 41 7th Street beginning August 17th and ending on August 22nd. Detour route will be from 16th Avenue to 5th Street and over on back to 8th Avenue to 7th Street. Detour is necessary as CSX will be working on crossings from 9th Avenue over to the railway diamond. If you will so approve, I'll notify.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
And I have another one I would like to add. Steve and I have discussed this earlier, but we want to get started on this work as we are ready. It's a road closure for a culvert replacement. This is at 15th Avenue and 4th Street. We would like to close this beginning Thursday, August the 6th. It's going to take approximately 2 weeks to replace the culvert. We're asking for the closure of 15th Avenue from 3rd to 5th Street and from 4th Street from 14.5 to 15.5 Avenue.
Second.
Motion and second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Quickly to the commission, I would like to update you the 8th Avenue winding project. We have the notice of substantial completion has been approved. Final completion and acceptance of the project to release the held retainage is contingent on the final inspection report from the Georgia Department of Transportation. Traffic signal has been installed and wired and is now operational as of last week. If you have been through there, we've had a lot of very nice compliments on that intersection now that work is complete. And also, I did want to let you know in our quad community project, the local government community affairs manager for CSX has informed me that the engineering for the circuit and crossing design has been completed. Now this goes to procurement for a pricing estimate and then on to legal for the formation of a contract on the project. We have to have this contract in the near future. Procurement, she told me, was fairly fast and furious. They have their price. Itemization is already there. She goes, it just depends on when it goes to legal, how much work they have ahead of them as to when we'll see that contract, but hopefully it will not be far away. And I would like to request an executive session for privileged matters to be presented to the commission.
Second. Motion and second for executive session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
And that's all I have, Mr. Chairman, unless there are other questions.
Any questions for Mr. Beach? Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir.
City Attorney's report.
I have something, but it needs to be an executive session, Mr. Chairman, if I could. Have you?
Yes, if we got it.
Okay. Yes, that's all.
All right. Do you have any finance threat?
No, sir, not other than the audit presentation.
All right, fire chief's report.
I don't have anything to add. I'll read report unless you have a question for me.
How's the northern convention?
Mr. Chairman, I have one. Announcement other than what I have in my written report. I want to let you all know and the public know that we have cleared all our special and general conditions from DCA. Did you mention that?
And I did not. Please.
We cleared all our special and general conditions from DCA and we got our grant notice and we are one step away from some activity in our CHIP program.
Good movement.
Very good. Personnel, right.
Mr. Chairman, you've got my report in your packet.
Unless you have any questions, I don't have anything to add. Anybody got any questions? Please, Chief.
Nothing to report at this time, sir.
All right. Thank you. Public Works Director.
I don't have anything, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Utility Davis.
I don't have anything to add to my written report, but I will update you on well levels. We had one well to drop 7 feet in the last 2 weeks, one to drop 5 feet, and the other four are holding pretty steady.
Okay. Thank you. Any other reports?
Hey, Jack. I'm over to John, Mr. Coleman.
We'll stand with John and have his late session in 5 minutes.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you.